This is The Critical Thinker, episode 12. Hi, everyone. I'm Kevin, and this is The Critical Thinker podcast. I teach philosophy for a living, and in my spare time, I produce this podcast and videos for the tutorial site criticalthinkeracademy.com. You might have noticed a name change since the last podcast. The old site was called criticalthinkingtutorials.com, which hosted both the podcast and the tutorial videos. But that site is no more. There have been some changes, which I'll elaborate on in a future episode. But these podcast episodes are now hosted on their own site, www.criticalthinkerpodcast.com. That's where you can go to view the show notes and leave comments on the podcast episodes. You can find the tutorial videos at www.criticalthinkeracademy.com. These are sister sites. They link to each other so you can move back and forth between them pretty easily. Anyway, this episode and the next episode are about cognitive biases and their importance for critical thinking. In this episode, I'm going to give a top-level overview of what cognitive biases are and why they're important. And next episode, I'm going to give a bunch of interesting examples of cognitive biases in action. Okay. Everyone agrees that logic and argumentation are important for critical thinking. One of the things that I've tried to emphasize on the podcast is that background knowledge is also very important. And there are different types of background knowledge that are relevant to critical thinking in different ways. One of the most important types of background knowledge is knowledge of how our minds actually work, how human beings actually think and reason, how we actually form beliefs, how we actually make decisions. There are a lot of different scientific fields that study how our minds actually work. There's behavioral psychology, social psychology, cognitive neuroscience, a bunch of fields. Over the past 30 years, we've learned an awful lot about human reasoning and decision making. Now, a lot of this research was stimulated by the work of two important researchers, Daniel Kahneman and Amos Tversky, going back to the early 1970s. They laid the foundations for what is now called the biases and heuristics tradition in psychology. Now, to get a feel for the importance of this research, let's back up a bit. When studying human reasoning, you can ask two sorts of questions. One is a purely descriptive question. How do human beings in fact reason? The other is a prescriptive or normative question. How should human beings reason? What's the difference between good reasoning and bad reasoning? Now, when we study logic and argumentation, we're learning a set of rules and concepts that attempt to answer this second question, how should we reason? These are elements of a broader normative theory of rationality, of what it means to reason well. Actually, what we have is not one big theory of rationality, but a bunch of more narrowly focused theories that target reasoning in specific domains or under specific conditions. So, for example, when we're interested in truth-preserving inferences, we appeal to deductive logic and interpret the rules of deductive logic as norms for reasoning in this area. When we're interested in reasoning about chance and uncertainty, we appeal to probability theory and statistics to give us norms for correct reasoning in this area. If we're talking about making choices that will maximize certain goals under conditions of uncertainty, then we appeal to formal decision theory. If we add the situation where other actors are making choices that can affect the outcomes of our decisions, then we're moving into what's called game theory. So, over time, we've developed a number of different theories of rationality that give us norms for correct reasoning in different domains. Now, this is great, of course. These are very powerful and useful tools. Now, when it comes to the study of how human reasoning actually works, before Kahneman and Tversky's work in the 1970s, there was a widely shared view that, more often than not, the mind, or the brain, processes information in ways that mimic the formal models of reasoning and decision-making that were familiar from our normative models of reasoning, from formal logic, from probability theory, from decision theory. What Kahneman and Tversky showed is that, more often than not, this is not the way our minds work. They showed that there's a gap between how our normative theories say we should reason and how we in fact reason. This gap can manifest itself in different ways, and there's no one single explanation for it. One reason, for example, is that in real-world situations, the reasoning processes prescribed by our normative theories of rationality can be computationally very intensive. Our brains would need to process an awful lot of information to implement our best normative theories of reasoning. But this kind of information processing takes time, and in the real world, we often need to make decisions much quicker, sometimes in milliseconds. You can imagine this time pressure being even more intense if you think about the situations facing our Homo sapien ancestors. there's a big animal charging you and you wait too long to figure out what to do, you're dead. So, the speculation is that our brains have evolved various shortcut mechanisms for making decisions. Especially when the problems we're facing are complex, we have incomplete information, and there's risk involved. In these situations, we sample the information available to us. We focus on just those bits that are most relevant to our decision task, and we make a decision based on a rule of thumb or a shortcut that just does the job. These rules of thumb are the heuristics in the so-called biases and heuristics literature. Now, two important things to note here. One is that we're usually not consciously aware of the heuristics that we're using or the information that we're focusing on. Most of this is going on below the surface. The second thing to note is that these heuristics aren't designed to give us the best solutions to our decision problems, all things considered. What they're designed to do is give us solutions that are good enough for our immediate purposes. But good enough might mean good enough in our ancestral environments where these cognitive mechanisms evolved. In contexts that are more removed from these ancestral environments, we can end up making systematically bad choices or errors in reasoning because we're automatically, subconsciously invoking the heuristic in a situation where that heuristic isn't necessarily the best rule to follow. So the term bias in this context refers to this systematic gap between how we're actually disposed to behave or reason and how we ought to behave or reason by the standards of some normative theory of reasoning or decision making. The heuristic is the rule of thumb that we're using to make the decision or the judgment. The bias is the predictable effect of using that rule of thumb in situations where it doesn't give an optimal result. I know this is all pretty general, so let me give you an example of a cognitive bias and its related heuristic. This is known as the anchoring heuristic, or the anchoring effect. Kahneman and Tversky did a famous experiment where they asked a group of subjects to estimate the percentage of countries in Africa that are members of the United Nations. Of course, most of us aren't going to know this. For most of us, this is just going to be a guess. Now, for one group of subjects, they asked the question, is this percentage more or less than 10%? For another group of subjects, they asked the question, is it more or less than 65%? Now, the average of the answers of the two groups differed significantly. In the first group, the average answer was 25%. In the second group, the average answer was 45%. The second group estimated higher than the first group. Why? Well, this is what seems to be going on. If subjects are exposed to a higher number, their estimates were anchored to that number. Give them a higher number, they estimate higher. Give them a lower number, they estimate lower. So the idea behind this anchoring heuristic is that when people are asked to estimate a probability or an uncertain number, rather than try to perform a complex calculation in their heads, they start with an implicitly suggested reference point, the anchor, and make adjustments from that reference point to reach their estimate. This is a shortcut. It's a rule of thumb. Now, you might think in this case, it's not just the number. It's the way the question is phrased that biased the estimates. You might think the subjects are assuming that the researchers know the answer and the reference number is therefore related in some way to the actual answer. But researchers have done this experiment many times in different ways. In one version, for example, the subjects are asked the same question to estimate the percentage of African nations in the UN. But before they answer, the researcher spins a roulette wheel in front of the group, waits for it to land on a number so they can all see the number, then ask them if the percentage of African nations is larger or smaller than the number on the roulette wheel. The results are the same. If the number is high, people estimate high. If the number is low, people estimate low. And in this case, the subjects couldn't possibly assume that the number on the roulette wheel had any relation to the actual percentage of African nations in the UN. But their estimates were anchored to this number anyway. Now, results like these have proven to be really important for understanding how human beings process information and make judgments on the basis of information. The anchoring effect shows up in strategic negotiation behavior, consumer shopping behavior, in the behavior of stock and real estate markets. It shows up everywhere. It's a very widespread and robust effect. And I note also that this behavior is, by the standards of our normative theories of correct reasoning, systematically irrational. This is an example of a cognitive bias. Now, this would be interesting, but not deeply significant, if the anchoring effect was the only cognitive bias that we've discovered. But if you go to Wikipedia and type in list of cognitive biases, you'll find a page that lists just over 100 of these biases, and the list is not exhaustive. I encourage everyone to check it out. If you spend much time looking at these links, you'll get a crash course in cognitive biases. So what's the upshot of all this for us as critical thinkers? Well, I'm going to get into this a bit more in the next podcast episode, but it's clear that, at the very least, we all need to acquire a certain level of cognitive bias literacy. We don't need to become experts, but we should all be able to recognize the most important and most discussed cognitive biases. We should all know what confirmation bias is, what the base rate fallacy is, what the gambler's fallacy is, and so on. These are just as important as understanding the standard logical fallacies. Why? Because as critical thinkers, we need to be aware of the processes that influence our judgments, especially if those processes systematically bias us in ways that make us prone to error and bad decisions. Also, we want to be on the lookout for conscious manipulation and exploitation of these biases by people who are in the influence business, whose job it is to make people think and act in ways that further their interests rather than your interests. We know that marketing firms and political campaigns hire experts in these areas to help them craft their messages. Now, let me give you a hypothetical example, though I know some people who'd say this is not hypothetical. Let's say you're a media advisor to a government that has just conducted a major military strike on a foreign country, and there were civilian casualties resulting from the strike. Now, if the number of civilians killed is high, then that's bad for the government. It'll be harder to maintain popular support for this action. Let's say our intelligence indicates that the number of casualties is in the thousands. This is not a good number. It's going to be hard to sell this action if that's the number that everyone reads in the news the next day. So as an advisor to this government, what do you recommend doing? I'll tell you what I would do if all I cared about was furthering the government's interests. I'd say, Mr. President, or whoever's in charge, we need to issue a statement before the press gets a hold of this. And in the statement, we need to say that the number of estimated casualties resulting from this strike is low, maybe 100 or 200 at the most. Now, why would I advise this? Because I know about the anchoring effect. I know that the public's estimate of the real number of casualties is going to be anchored to the first number they're exposed to. And if that number is low, they'll estimate low. And if data eventually comes out with numbers that are higher, the public's estimates will still be lower than they would be if we didn't get in there first and feed them that first low number. Now, that's what I would do if all I cared about was manipulating public opinion. This is a hypothetical example, but trust me when I tell you that decisions like these are made every day under the advice of professionals who are experts in this psychological literature. So there's a broader issue at stake. This is the kind of background knowledge that is important if our ultimate goal is to be able to claim ownership and responsibility for our own beliefs and values. And that's what critical thinking is all about. Well, that's going to wrap it up for this episode. In the next episode, I'm going to look at a few more case studies to help highlight how important cognitive biases are and maybe give you some more incentive to look into them. I'll leave some links in the show notes to some online resources, which you can find at www.criticalthinkerpodcast.com. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time.